Good evening and welcome to Frankly Speaking, where truth is our mission, reality our realm, set as we see it, and frankly as well.
But it's the next iteration of an existing system.
But it's a design. It's not manufacturing anything.
I think there should be, there are restrictions. You have to be licensed to carry a weapon.
Addiction, and I think that if we took a more compassionate approach, we might find more of a solution.
Radical swing of the pendulum. Now we're, more liberal, more progressive, more.
It's time for us to honor those folks who, send comments to it.
And good evening. I'm Joe Spina, back from D.C. with my dear, dear colleague, Paul Crowley. And we're going to get into that. We have the mall, the ball, City Hall, and women. Trump, not at all. How do you like
that?
Wow,
that all rhymes.
It does. And so doesn't the fact that, by the way, don't forget, folks, our mission is what? Truth.
Truth, yeah, okay,
right?
yep.
As we see reality.
It. Truth as we see it.
No, truth as it is.
Alternative facts?
That's the other guys.
Okay. Okay.
By the way, a lot of alternative facts. You can keep your health care if you want it.
Yeah, well, I see alternative facts as an alternative set of facts that lead you to a different conclusion than the truth. Not necessarily a falsehood.
Okay.
Right.
Reality,
that's what they were trying to say, right? I mean, that was the intention of the term. They weren't trying to say, we made up our own facts and we're lying. They said our facts gave us this conclusion. So as far as we were concerned, it was true, right?
Oh, let's give some facts. Shortly. I have to finish up.
All right, let's get back
intro.
To the things
wait,
that
wait,
rhyme,
get,
right?
Got the intro done.
By the way, you know what also rhymes with ball, hall, all, and City Hall, what are all those for?
Paul,
there you go.
Pretty good, huh? Yeah. You didn't think I was that bright, did you? But you got to understand something.
No, but you just don't rhyme.
You don't rhyme
with...
Jesse Jackson and I are at the same club. I'm an ecumenical type of guy. I'm not just a right winger, as people purport to think.
So I guess you got the thumbs up to wear the scarf, huh?
I did. Yep. The lovely ladies told me to wear the scarf,
okay.
If you don't mind. Yeah. It's part of my signature.
All right, so let's talk about... The ball, right?
I want to talk about the mall.
The mall.
Because you talked about alternative facts. And the mall was packed, Paul. You and I were there, so we can attest to it.
Right. Yeah, it was standing room only for sure. It's interesting. If you look at that, the picture that they were showing, they showed all the bald spots from the overview.
Yeah.
Think about it. There were bald spots that were like right up close. Right? Why would anybody not go right up close? I mean, if people are getting in there, the first thing they're going to do is all move up front, right?
First of all, Paul, Reuters today has come out and said that Trump has a point, meaning that the photographs that were shown, the aerial photographs, were were of a different time.
They said 11:09, but I'll bet you it was not. It was probably much earlier in the day. 11:09 was actually, 21 minutes before the program started?
Yes, Paul.
And it looked like there was nobody there. And it looked like there was nobody there.
Now, let me make another point, observation, before we go to the ball, which was a ball.
Right.
Listen, there was, as I see it, will you tell me otherwise? Did you see any protests?
No.
It was impossible.
There were protests. They arrested 200 people.
Not within the
confines. Not where we were, right.
Not in any, it was impossible.
Inside it was, because it was very secure. There were
very
police.
Secure?
National gun, no guns though.
They had them,
but they weren't like.
What I thought was amazing? I saw the Secret Service guys that wrote Secret Service, and I was wondering why they told us they were Secret Service with "secret" written on them. It wasn't very secret, was it?
Right.
But the Secret Service was there. Gliss was not Gliss.
Ice.
I was, Ice was
Gliss
there.
Was there.
Yeah, you were Gliss. Yeah. The marshals were there.
Yep.
Everybody.
The National Guard.
TSA was there.
Yeah, right.
The soldiers all over the place. Yep. They had the Capitol Police. And
I was there. We got a picture with a woman who was from Virginia, I think.
We're going to get a picture of you.
Yep.
I got some pictures of you, Paul. None of me, thank you very much.
But here, you were talking about, was it a full crowd? The media was clearly trying to suggest that nobody really cares about Donald Trump and the inauguration and didn't go there. That was the intent, right? And they by saying that there were, it was a non-participated event, right? When we left, and you were going pretty slow, I would say that people were passing us at 200 people per second. We were going, that's how
I was wounded.
But there were a lot of people leaving, and we left when it was over.
We could not get into the subway because the volume was so enormous.
For over an hour.
More than that, because we sat on the steps where you met all the celebrities. You know,
yep.
David Webb from Fox, you know, he said, came up to you and you made some wise statement to him. He had a nice looking girlfriend, though, I'll tell you that right now. And then Joe the Plumber took a hike by, and who else got...
Jerry Falwell Jr.
And a number of others.
But that's why we were waiting, and it was like rock solid people.
Rock solid.
And it wasn't the line was not going down; it just stayed like that because they would let 1,000 people in
to get into the metro.
Right.
Okay. And then the only way we got around it was because Paul Folks was hungry, and he somehow found.
But you weren't though, right?
Of course I was. Take a look at my belly. So in any case. We went to a place you found on the side.
Right.
There. It was a beautiful noodle place, which was interesting.
Yeah.
Korean, wasn't it? Korean?
I don't...
But all I know
is... Asian. It was some type of Asian food, and it was great. We got to design our own meal, whatever, and we ate, and by the time we were finished, the subway had cleared out.
It had abated itself.
So we probably... It was probably 2 hours, right, between when
At least.
So 2 hours it took between when we left till we could actually get on the subway.
Paul, have you ever gone to a football game at Foxborough?
Yeah.
All right.
Half an hour it takes to clear out.
60,000 people in no time, right?
It's a half hour, it's awful, but then it's gone.
Right. We were a solid 2 hours, could not move that line.
And that was only one exit.
That's right.
There was 3rd Street, and so then you got on the other side, maybe. We were on the west side, so on the east side. And then further up near the Capitol, I'm sure there was another set of exits that went to subway stations as well. So, you know, you could say, I was thinking 300,000 or 400,000 people just where we were.
And we were way
back. And
there
was probably four exits. So, anywhere. So
a million and change.
Right.
And by the way, folks, seriously, the images that are portrayed and what is really is striking, there were more folks running around there with whatever the Sikhs wear from India and Pakistan.
The Sikhs.
What do they call?
Sikhs.
How many people?
A lot of them. Yeah.
I mean, it was unbelievable.
Well, I mean, they stand out because of the headgear.
Well, obviously, but they're trying to make the narrative that the Republican Party is a lily white party. Paul, I saw more minorities there than I saw, you know, at the ball.
Right. Yep. That's right.
All right. So, Parashat, and as far as the women, there were women all over the place. The women voted for Trump, I hate to tell you.
And I'll tell you what, everybody was very pleasant. There was,
yes, they were.
All very nice people. You could talk to them. We met a couple. Remember we met the Undertaker?
Oh, God. That's a great story in itself. Don't threaten the Undertaker. Now, let's get to the ball because, you know, we won't have any time at all. It was spectacular, Paul.
Right. That building was huge, wasn't it?
Oh. How about those brownies? I love the brownies.
I admit... It's been 5+ years since I've had gluten, but I had 3 brownies at the ball. Right.
We had to. And you know, we were at Freedom Hall.
Yes.
And Freedom Hall was where all of the major networks had set up shop.
Right.
Everybody was walking by us on the way up to
Congressman Louis Gohmert. Right.
Oh, he loved Joe.
We got a chance to talk to him for a little bit.
How about with him when he had 6 chocolate chip cookies in his hand?
And he had to eat them before he got up to found his wife, right?
Yeah, but he was scheduled to go on.
Yep.
And then we saw Angelina Jolie's father.
We did? Oh, yeah, John Voight.
John Voight. He's a husky guy.
Scott Baio was there.
Yeah, he was there with his wife.
Right.
And who was that guy from New York City that's Fox all the time? He's got the beard. He always doesn't shave. He's got that little, the cop, the former cop. Deal, something like that.
Bo Deedle.
That's him.
Yeah.
He was there.
Yeah. Judge Jeanine Pirro.
Let me, folks.
65 years old.
65 years old, and let me tell you, she's sassy and she is unbelievable,
right.
Isn't
yeah.
she?
Yeah.
She is a really fine-looking woman.
And we saw Richard Grenell.
Oh yeah.
The former spokesman for the UN.
Yeah.
Sean Hannity, Tucker Carlson.
Geraldo
Rivera.
Yeah.
John Voight.
Who's the one on the Fox Morning? The new one? Angie. You mentioned her name. I said, what a stunning woman she is. Earhart or something like that?
Ainsley Earhart.
That's it.
You saw her? I didn't see her.
I pointed her out to you. The other one that told me it was her.
No.
Yes, you did. It's getting senile, folks.
All right, whatever. So there were a lot of celebrities there, but not the least of which was Joe Spina and Paul Crowley, though, right?
Even better. They approached us, did they not?
Right.
I mean, the last...
We did apply for media credentials, although we didn't get them.
Well, they denied them for a specific reason.
Right.
Because
we're too far down.
Why would you give credentials to folks from the city of Lynn, from the state of Massachusetts, when you have Elizabeth Warren and you have Markey?
Because they're the most conservative people in the city of Lynn.
Yeah, that's true, but it's a waste of energy. I mean, Massachusetts is a kiss-off.
No, I think that may be part of the reason. I think it was more because we're a local cable access as opposed to, you know, they got to give them to all the major networks and all the regionals.
Really?
You know, and by the time they get down to us, you know, there's no spots left. Yeah, I think that's part of it.
Well, while we're there at the ball with Trump dancing, by the way, speaking of stunning.
Your wife is stunning. Yeah.
I mean, Melania, and she's classy.
Yeah.
Classy. You know, the folks that were there were all, well, like you said, well-mannered, polite, well-dressed.
Easy to have a conversation with.
Very easy.
And I'll tell you what.
And the food was great, by the way.
And I've been at events before where the room is decidedly liberal. Not so much. And it's not everybody, but there's a lot of snobs in that environment.
Paul, you pointed something out to me at that Freedom Ball that I hadn't realized.
What's that?
It was how big that hall was.
It was.
And if it was wall-to-wall people in that hall, which it was, that hall had to be... You told me they could land 747s in there. Yeah. That's how big it was.
Well, when we first got in there,
you
know, it was early. I kind of pushed you over. Joe had to move him around in a little wheelchair so we could get around pretty good. I thought you were right in the middle. We had you right in front of the bar. The food was right there. And then you were looking straight at the screen, right?
Exactly.
And I figured we were in the middle. But we were, like, on the edge.
We were on the outer end, way out. I know that because when you vanished on me, the reason why he's alluding to is I have bad knees, and I had just had a procedure done that day, and I couldn't really walk that well. And so when they saw me limping, the nice folks immediately ran over and put me in a wheelchair. Paul never thought about doing that.
Oh, stop it. I went to get the wheelchair.
But anyway, go ahead.
Alternative facts here.
Good one, though. Hey, look, here's how the whole trip started, folks. You want to talk about challenges? We end up on a train that breaks down in Providence right off the get-go. The engine goes up in flames, right? Yep.
40 minutes into the trip, we're on an express, and they make us wait an hour, and then we get on a local, which stops at every stop all the way to D.C.
Exactly. 3 hours more, and do they refund us or give us a better seat? No.
We got a better seat.
Yeah, I liked it better, to be honest with you. So anyways, we got there real late at night. Of course, Paul went to the wrong corner, and, you know.
He talked me right through the stop. That's what he did.
This
guy, you think he can talk?
Did we go through a stop?
You think he can talk for the hour on the show? How do you think he does for 10 hours in a row? Anybody want to guess at who was doing most of the talking for the 10 hours?
You enjoyed it.
I did?
You did.
Oh, okay.
So, Melania, and it was beautiful watching them dance. You and I watched them dance. And it was really a light and beautiful.
It was live, right? And it had his entire family was there. Mm-hmm. The vice president was there, Mike Pence and his wife, and they all got out and they were dancing. And we got some photos, I think, of the dancing, right?
Yeah.
It was pretty cool because remember right before they showed up, we were all of a sudden we saw the guys running by with the earpieces on, and we could tell something was up. And all the Secret Service were making sure that everything was.
What I was really pleased about was how well protected
the entire thing. They checked and double checked us on the way
everywhere.
And then once we got in, we could do whatever we want. There was no, they weren't like.
Oh, but there were people watching.
Oh, sure.
But we weren't aware of who they were. Now, as we were there at the ball and at the mall, here at City Hall, flashback, was none other than Isaac. And who are those folks? What's the name of that group that...
I don't remember the name of the group.
I think it's Lynn United for Change.
Something like that.
Yeah, about 50 of them showed up. And they're on the stairs. And what fascinates me is that I have no idea why they were there. Why are you there? They said, because when Trump attacks, is Trump attacking anybody that you know of?
the media.
Yeah, but when he attacks, they're going to fight back.
It's always a counter.
They're going to fight back, Paul. And by the way, Judy, dastardly, Judy, you know, she doesn't represent Lynn. She's a Trump supporter. And I like to say to you, Isaac, by the way, you're invited to come on the show, right? To tell us your view, opposing view. But, you know, she got a few more votes.
When that story was written, he had been president for like half an hour, right? And they're already talking about impeaching him, and, you know, and that he's a terrible president and all this stuff. Then give the guy a chance, for crying out loud. You know, you got to come around eventually.
Oh, because
it's all about the country, right? And the people in the country. It's not about whether you like him or not. I mean, look, I know they're not going to like his policies. I didn't like Obama's for 8 years, but I tolerated it.
But the point is this. How can you make the statement that Judy Kennedy is somehow, because she is a supporter of Trump, that she doesn't represent the citizens of Lynn? And that somehow Lynn United for Change does. They had 50 people, maybe.
Right.
I doubt it. That's probably inflated. Right. That showed up. We were with 1.2 million, 1.5 million. Okay? Right. And she was there. Now, here's the point. She blew the doors off of a candidate that's credible.
Right.
Correct?
Yep.
So if anyone wants to complain about the mayor, go out and get the votes. How about that one?
Right.
I mean, who is he to say? Did he have the votes that she got?
No.
How much did she beat Phelan by?
3,000? What was that? Do you have a picture of the it says, Lynn does not support Trump. It's like...
Yeah. We put it up there, yeah. So,
because a group of 40 or 50 people are...
Yeah, and who are they to speak for me? I'm from Lynn.
Yeah, I'm for Trump.
Yeah.
I think he's doing a great job.
Everybody knows I'm for Trump. So...
Very early, too. You predicted it.
Well, I did. And we're going to show something. I don't know whether they have a picture of somebody who's close and dear to me that may come up there. And it's an interesting graphic because my granddaughter... And you know my granddaughter is sitting standing alongside, guess who, Paul? Paul, are you with us?
Yes.
Who's my granddaughter sitting beside? Standing beside, rather.
Former Vice President Joe Biden.
That's right.
That's nice. And finally get to say former.
And his wife with her fiancé, correct? Yep. I think he's a Democrat.
Last I checked, yeah.
Yeah. Am I all bummed out of shape because my granddaughter is there at a Christmas party?
I have a lot of friends who are Democrats.
No kidding.
And Lynn, you have to.
So you Demis out there, and you liberals, why don't you try having a little fun with us?
Yeah, reach out. We don't shake hands.
Do you have horns? I don't have a tail. I don't think. You know, I mean, I'm sick of it. I like to have fun. And then afterwards, who cares? When you play basketball and you play it all the time.
Yeah.
When you're playing against those guys, you want to beat them?
Bad.
Badly, right?
Yeah.
What about afterwards?
Yeah, I was hanging out with them and chewing the fat with them after the game.
You don't want to impeach them?
I don't.
Did they blame you that the Russians interfered with you beating them? Huh?
An over 50 league is a little different than winning the game of President of the United States, though, don't you think?
Yeah, but I mean, the principle is the same, Paul.
It is, you're right.
And that's the whole point, so they take it too seriously. Hey, let's turn to Lynn things a little bit.
We've been asked to
get that. And by the way, we're going to get back. We're going to read commentaries. We got a whole bunch of them on the second part of the last part of our show. But the very first thing that pops up, and Paul, I wish you could help me on this because this really fascinates me. And it has to do with, and I don't have it here, unfortunately. Apparently, tonight, because we tape on Tuesday, right?
Yep.
Tonight, the city council is going to vote to put on the ballot for the citizens to vote.
The referendum on two, I think it's two questions. One is to approve a bond.
Yeah.
To build the schools. And the other is to increase taxes. I think
it's going to cost $200 for 25 years per household. That's what they say. So you know
that's on average.
Yeah.
And that means that everybody who is above average will be paying $300-$500, and everybody who's below average will be paying $100-$150.
Yeah, and here's the worst. But now, if you put that together with another fact, by the way, that's coming out on the second part of this Lynn things, is that I was shocked by this. Do you know that less than 50% of the people residing in Lynn are homeowners?
You mean more than 50% are homeowners?
Less than 50% are homeowners.
Oh.
And there's the folks that are carrying the burden for paying for the schools.
Right.
So that tax rate, and you would think that homeowners, if you have low homeowners, you would have low right. populations in your schools, but we don't.
So the
Why?
Dirty little secret is
yeah,
that
is
in addition to this ballot initiative, which is going to essentially get the voters, taxpayers to approve a significant increase in taxes to cover the bond and the bond itself. That's for something new, right?
Uh-huh.
Putting that aside just for a moment, this year not a problem. They've managed to make this work this year, but next year, they still don't know where they're going to get the money to balance the budget for next year. That's
but the
over
item,
and above this.
But the item runs with a story talking about $35 million the city of Lynn allegedly saved because of some settlement out of a suit, which is fictitious. It's
they,
as if
they
we got
lose.
Found money, right?
Right.
Okay. Which, so that they can come back with an editorial talking about how important it is to build these two schools and put that question on
that's
the ballot.
That's a pretty good observation because, you know, to some extent, you know, they're trying to suggest that you can take this big number to build the schools and drop it by 35 right off the bat. That's a very good observation.
Of money that never exists in the first place.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And,
okay.
And the worst thing, the only thing that could have happened is they would have been forced to pay it, not, you know.
Yeah, but they would have always settled that figure way
right.
down.
It wasn't like they had the money sitting aside.
No.
Now they can take it back.
No. So apparently, they're claiming $75 million. Now, let's take a look at some facts and some figures. This is predicated on this, that there's a 3% increase ad infinitum of students coming into the city of Lynn. For example, 500 additional students came in this year. That's a 3% increase over other years. Well, that's not necessarily going to be the case. At some point in time, that figure is going to abate itself, right? I mean, you're not going to get 3% increase in children in the school system year in and year out, because you might as well forget about building schools.
Right.
You know?
Yep.
Okay?
Right.
So, that bothers me a little bit. Now they come up with figures. Listen to this one, Paul, if you can expect it. By the way, that special election is March 14th. We expect from here on in, from now until that date, to have either John Ford from the school committee and people who are opposed get on our show 10, 15 minutes so we can get the real facts out to the folks that can make an informed decision.
That's
about
a good
this.
That's a good idea. We should
okay?
do that for sure. Yeah.
Because, you know, build and build. There's two things here. You build, but then you got a bill coming to you.
Right.
You may look, does everybody want a good education for the kids in a great school? Everybody.
Right.
Question is, can you do it?
Right.
You know? So
I think the UN should pay for the school.
Mm-hmm.
The UN, United Nations, they should pay for the school.
They should. Right. They're the ones to send the refugees here that designate
yep.
us, and that's where our problem lies.
Yep.
All right, here we go. They claim that, and these figures always bother me, they say it's a $188 million project, the two schools. And then all of a sudden down the bottom it says the Department of Massachusetts School Building Authority.
MSBA, right.
Very good, Paul.
Yep.
Well, they're going to contribute 60%. So that makes it nice. But it's 60% of, guess what, $113 million. Somehow or another, $75 million
right.
evaporated.
Well, that's how it was all, that's how they did it with the, remember they did it when they built the Marshall School?
Yeah, they gave it 20 figures.
They said the city only has to pay 20%, but then after it was approved, they said, what we meant to say was 20% of everything except for this, and this.
Very good. So then it costs about $40, $50 million, right?
Right. All right.
So if you take the $113 million that they claim that we get 60% of, reimbursed from the state, and you add the $75 million that they claim the bond is going to go out for, you add those two figures together, bingo, you get 188, conveniently.
Right.
So this is a shell game.
Oh, of course.
So what happens is we pony up $75 million, but they're only paying 60% of the $113 million, which means 40% of the $113 million is going to be added on to the 75, doesn't it?
Yep, it does. Yep.
Huh?
Right.
Are they going to tell the folks that stuff?
No, we just did.
I know.
That's what truth lives right here, right?
How do you like this quote? Public schools are everybody's right and everybody's responsibility.
Who said that?
That was said by none other than...
Is that the editorial?
Tommy mm-hmm. Arabino, I believe, said this. Enrollment continues to grow and we are out of space. Said Let me ask you something.
I have a question. So yep. Everybody's entitled to an education, right?
Yeah.
Everybody has the right to an education. But it doesn't seem like everybody has the right to a good education, because all the other things get in the way, like the needs of the teachers, the needs of the administrators, you know, this, that, and the other thing, and the needs of all these additional people coming. So, I mean, having the right to an education isn't enough for me. I want the right to a good education.
Paul, in other parts of the world...
As I see it.
You're right.
Right.
In other parts of the world, they're doing much better than we, industrialized world, education. We're, out of 35 industrialized nations, we're like 31st.
Is that right?
We're down the bottom, overall. And once again, you can check those, you know, they pluck them out of air.
Right.
But the point, and we spend more per pupil than anybody else. Now, in these other places, they're not building schools every other day. They take, these schools have been around for 500 years in Europe and other places. They retrofit them. They have character. They still, I don't understand, I mean, we have some beautiful buildings that could be...
Right, that's an important point. That's an important distinction. Does the school, the fact that it's a new school versus an old school, change the dynamics of the education? I think it's, you know, it's good if it's a new school and all that kind of stuff. But the learning has to be the same, right? I mean, doesn't it matter that you have the right textbooks and the right teachers and they're doing, you know, and they're encouraging kids to come to school and they're building character and doing...
Of course.
The building itself is an inanimate, you know?
Exactly. I mean, is the character of a family determined by the eloquence of their home?
No.
That's the point you're making.
Yep.
So we're going to have to look into this, folks, and we'll keep going back and forth with it because, you know, it's a big piece of change that they're looking at, and it's certainly going to be more than the $75 million advertised. And this is on top of an increase we just got. As right. we predicted, we
right.
just, I just got hit with over $300 a year.
Right, and I have 400. And as I was saying earlier, the CFO is saying that he doesn't know how we're going to balance the budget in the next fiscal year. That's without regard to anything related
and
to
all,
a bond.
And all contracts have not been settled yet.
Right.
Here's an idea: how much does the teachers' union charge a teacher per year? Do you think to belong to the union?
I don't know.
How about if
500,000, something like that?
Well, per so how much should the average teacher
50
pay?
A week? 50 I, weeks, $2,500.
So you're saying two to grand, something like that?
Do you have to pay dues?
Not anymore.
You don't?
I used to.
What did you pay?
But you can opt out.
How much did you can. This is a right to work state?
Now. You can opt out. But my point to you is simply this. If people are very serious, why don't the teachers take a vote and say, okay, of that $2,500 I'm giving, you know, paying to you, we want to divert 500. We're going to be generous. We're going to divert 500 of those dollars to go for building a new school, which will help offset the cost of the city of Lynn.
Yeah.
Would that be a good idea? Do you think that would ever happen?
Nice try, Joe.
Exactly. But wouldn't that be the magnanimous and the right thing to do? Because there are a
they're
lot of
they're asking
teachers.
Everybody to buck up, right? But when,
wait a minute.
But they exclude the teachers from that.
Does
everybody.
Does everybody that works in the city of Lynn, in the school department, live in Lynn and reside in Lynn?
No.
Okay, so they don't care what the costs are. They're not paying for it. They're going to protect the community in which they maintain a certain, you know, their household, you know, ownership is probably 95%. Okay, so they got a wonderful, wonderful property tax base, which we don't have, Paul.
You know, I haven't really thought about that. You know, all this talk over the years about you know, the police and fire having to live in the city and all that kind of stuff. You know, residency laws and all that kind of stuff. I hadn't thought about that. You know, And the police, I think they have a pretty good argument for wanting to leave. They don't want to be in the community that they're serving because of issues that could arise because they come in contact with people that they had issues with or whatever. But if you think about it, just like you said, if they leave the city, then they can really promote tax increases and they don't even have to pay for it.
Exactly. That's exactly what happens.
Right.
And so here's the part I'm saying. You know, I've never been for this because I'm supposed to be one of these laissez-faire libertarian Republicans, you know, all these bad guys.
I thought it was because you were in the union, or you used to be.
What I'm saying is this, you know, there's a case to be made that we should have a city income tax. People who work in the city, we made you, your eyes lit up.
Hush your mouth.
I mean, but think about it. Think about it.
Hey, look, Joe is not proposing city income tax.
Wait a minute.
Are you?
What I'm proposing is this. If you have a lot of people who are benefiting in the city of Lynn.
Well, that's a good idea. So we can, so city income tax from those city workers, in other words.
That's what I was trying to tell you, Paul. Oh. I wish you picked up on it.
No.
For those individuals who earn a living out of the city of Lynn, who benefit from it, maybe they should pony back a little bit of their bonuses, so to speak, right?
Yeah, so run for mayor on that theme, you get run out of town.
Why? The people, because it only affects the people
of the organized minority, you know.
I understand that, but I'm talking about people who purport to be for Lynn that don't live in the city. We have people who run our newspapers who don't live in the city, Paul, and they're trying to tell the city how to run its business.
Right.
All right, so that doesn't quite sit right with me, Paul.
Okay, I'm with you.
Okay? Yeah. And it doesn't quite sit right with me about these outside, you know, they use this term, Greater Lynn. What does that mean? That means they'll tell Lynn, oh, by the way, Lynn, you're going to have the halfway house. Oh, and by the way, one of our comments has to do with that, about the halfway houses that we have in abundance,
right.
And then we have crime problems and wonder why, as if no correlation between the two. Well, these Greater Lynn folks.
Because this is where all the services
are. All these Greater Lynn folks, right. They want to keep them here. They don't want them in the Greater Lynn area,
right.
If you follow me.
Yeah, a lot of the people who provide the services for these folks don't live in Lynn. At the end of the day, although I know one person who does it, who lives in Lynn.
Yeah, you live in Lynn.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But many others don't.
Yep.
So what's happening now is apparently there's a guy named Craig Seymour, and he is a spokesperson for the RKG Associates. And they got together with the Lynn Business Partnership, and they had a meeting about the state of development in the city of Lynn. And they said there's potential, but with potential, Paul, what is there always? Basic obstacles, many obstacles. Huge obstacles was the definition. And then they turned around that we have much needed apartment construction. I don't buy that. I don't think we have much needed apartment construction, because that is going to cut home ownership down even further. I think we need ownership.
There's no place to build houses, though.
You don't have to build houses. You can build condos. That's ownership.
Right.
Okay? You can build co-ops in apartment buildings. That's ownership. Not rental. You have to buy. They have that all over New York and all over many, many dense metropolitan areas. They pay real estate tax, Paul. And you know what? Most of them don't have that many kids. So therefore, they're not taxing the school system, correct?
Yep.
Right. As opposed to that development that's happening down there on Washington Street, in which they have 1, 2, 3 bedrooms, and are all for low income.
Some of them are market rate, and some of them are below market rate.
Mm. Yeah, well, the 3 bedrooms are certainly below market rate.
The Beacon site is all market rate, though.
Allegedly. $2,000.
No, it's not allegedly. I know for a fact.
Well, they have to fill it first. Because they're anchoring. Listen, Paul, since all of the stuff you told me, you want me to give you the names? Moulton. You know him? Representative Moulton. Charlie Baker. Thing called LEAD. L-E-A-D. Right?
Jay Ash.
All right.
Yeah.
Jay Ash, your guy. He's from the Department of Secretary of Housing and Economic Department.
Yeah.
Right? Jay Ash. Then you have Stephanie Pollack, and she's the Environmental Secretary.
No, Transportation.
Oh, Transportation, you're right. And then you have Matthew Beaton and the mayor. They've been at this for a while. Now here's the quote. Have been unable to attract a single new developer to build housing on the water side of the Linway. Not a one. Now the Beacon Chevrolet is their hope that they can fill it up at the $2,000 a month, which I would not go to at $2,000 a month. Too ricksy for me.
I'd like to go there.
$2,000 a month?
I'm gonna rent the first unit.
Good luck to you.
Top floor overlooking.
Well, if
they
get $2,000 a month, they claim that that's an 8% return for investors and that that might have them come into the city. So they're saying places like Chelsea Riviera and Everett are getting $350 to $400 a square foot. Is that about right, Paul? You're better at that than I am.
I would say that's about right, yep.
So what should Lynn be getting a square foot?
Maybe 20% below that.
How much?
20% below that.
So 20% of, we'll call it 8, that's 320 as opposed to 4. They consider Lynn high risk to come here, and they're resistant on doing it. And that bothers me, Paul, because it's very important for the city of Lynn to expand its base, because we cannot afford to build schools, we cannot afford to give pay raises, we cannot afford to go the way we're going, We're going
right. Like I've always said, I've said this on the show, I said it while I was on the city council, it's the same thing. There's a balancing act that has to go on. There has to be, a balancing act between those who are taxpayers and income producers to those who need services and are income absorbers.
Well, as the latter, as a guy that's paying $5,100 a year in real estate tax, not to count my water bill,
right,
which is going to go up, and that's a virtual tax.
By the way, we haven't really talked about this, and I know there was a story in the paper not long ago, but we're under obligation now to do a water separation project in West Lynn that's going to cost $110 million. You don't even hear much about that. There's not a lot of talk about that, but it's happening.
And there's a lot to be said that it may not work. It's an iffy thing. It's not
well,
that it will resolve the problem. That's for a few floodings that take place.
Right. Well, the intent is not to solve the flooding problem.
What's
although
the
intent? The intent is to reduce the level of discharge into Lynn Harbor to an acceptable level for the DEP.
When I was on the Lynn Water Sewer Commission way back when, they built a primary treatment plant.
Yep.
To which I argued that's insane. You might as well build a tertiary. Cost a few million dollars more, but you wouldn't have the problem you're talking about, okay? The coefficient of friction is like arteriosclerosis. Those pipes have been there for a long time, and they've narrowed,
right,
and they're corroded. In order to build them at that time, using $1980, it was about 10 million per mile to extend the outflow pipe. You don't have people with long visions doing things here. You understand
right
that?
Right. Anyone who did like you got kicked out after
they
one time.
Real fast.
Right.
Okay. Not only that, you have to put aside. There are things called put asides. You're an accountant. You understand. If you have a commodity, water is a commodity to be sold. If it costs X amount to deliver that water, if you put a little bit on top of that to derive a profit, not a big profit, and you put that profit into what is known as the rainy day fund, which everybody taps immediately so that they can say, oh, I just lowered the rate so I can get elected again. No, but if they left it alone, the money would accrue so that your tax rates would remain stable or go down over time, and all the things you want to get built will happen.
It was based on a capital budget plan.
Exactly.
That makes sense. That's what we do with GLIS every day.
This is why I voted for Donald Trump, because Donald Trump is a businessman, and I love his cabinet. Because his cabinet are businessmen.
Right.
And the thing about businessmen is they're bottom line oriented.
Right.
All right. So when I see that they want to slash this and that they're not going to hire anybody by attrition and they're going to get rid of this and get rid of that, I applaud it.
Right.
Because you know what, Paul? Ultimately, those folks that need services are going to get them because there's going to be money to do it.
Right.
If you go this way, nobody's going to have anything.
Right.
This is the problem, and don't the people in the city understand that? If they keep electing the same people with the same mindsets over and over and over again, they should get on their hands and knees and thank Judy.
Well, one of the things that I've always said, and this is a little frustrating thing for me, and that is that it seems as though when we elect somebody, that you know, there's kind of they get raised up onto a pedestal, and we, you know, bow when they come into the room, and I'm being facetious, but the fact of the matter is that we hold them to high esteem, and what we really should be doing is be holding them to a high standard of what we expect out of them. They work for us, but we hire them to take over these jobs, and then we take what we get, and we don't push back and say, you know, that's not enough, I need more. You know, Trump says it all the time. He says, I don't want, we're done talking. We're going to start taking action.
What pronoun does he use, Paul?
Action.
No, what's his pronoun? We.
We, oh yeah.
We. His pronoun is we. What was the former president's pronoun?
I and me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So he says, we. I'm your messenger.
Right.
You are my boss.
Right. Which is the way it needs to be, yeah.
And when you and I were at that ball, with all of these supporters and all of these quote-unquote celebrities, political celebrities, et cetera, and others, did you get a sense that any of those folks thought they were better than anybody else?
No, I didn't.
Smarter than anybody else?
Not a bit.
You know, got out of bed better than anybody else?
They were very easy to talk to, friendly, having a good time and just, you know, like Louis Gohmert, Congressman Gohmert, said, "I've been smiling all day."
Oh, I don't think I'm. Chocolate chip cookies.
It wasn't the chocolate chip cookies. It was the the inauguration. Yeah.
Beginning February 6th, Paul, frankly speaking, we'll have a new time slots. We'll be on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 12 p.m. noontime. You know, while they're having their little brunch, they can watch us and enjoy.
And then again at 8?
And 8 o'clock. So they can digest their food better.
Right. So starting February 6th, that week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, noon and 8 o'clock in the evening will be our show.
Right.
Prime time. We got the prime time 8 o'clock slot. We're going to be going up against O'Reilly.
He's nothing. You know, we got some comments we got to go over. One has to do with halfway houses in Lynn. Uh-huh. And the net bottom line is that, and perhaps I pirated his idea. In fact, I did. He said that there's been a number of shootings, right? And he says that maybe these halfway houses, the volume of them, the city of Lynn is out of whack. Needs a little better balance. What do you think?
Well, you know,
why do we have a
couple of things that, so the halfway house, you know, it's, you know, that term, that expression, build it and they will come, you know, like from Field of Dreams and all that kind of stuff. It kind of applies here, but it's from the perspective of the people that are building them, there's a great need for people with substance abuse issues, and they got to build this house, they got to develop this housing. So I'm not suggesting, and by the way, there was a whole bunch of them on the street I grew up on. There still are a whole bunch of them on the street I grew up on. And they were being added there over the years. And they always seem to get it done by right, which is very interesting. For those who are objecting to this, when somebody says you can do it by right, that means you can't object. And in fact, there was a development down on Green Street. It wasn't a halfway house, but it was a transitional housing for homeless people. And this is for families with children, which is it's a good thing. But they actually put it in and never had to talk to the neighborhood about it. By right.
What was the crime situation on Graham Street?
When I was growing up, it was probably pretty bad. It's probably still pretty bad.
So our viewer has a point that there's a correlation between halfway houses and crime.
Well, when I was a kid, crime was pretty bad there, and there were no halfway houses.
So it was an accident.
I told you what the corollary is.
So do they?
It's socioeconomic.
Okay.
If you don't have any money, you steal.
Well, think about that. Do you know, or did not you know, guys, I did not know, they're saying, I can't even read this thing, you should help me out here, Paul. Did not you guys were such fancy boys? I don't know how it's phrased it that way, but anyways, we got a compliment that we're fancy boys. Apparently they saw us in our tux. And they want to know whether we saw Judy down there, and actually we didn't.
We talked with her a couple of times. We never actually connected, but there were, you know, there was a.
We were two.
There were anywhere from 800,000 to a million two people there.
And we were rock and rolling with celebrities, anyhow.
Right.
This is the one way you brought up casually. We're on the train that blew up, and across from me is this guy reading books, falling asleep, and all of a sudden. You started talking to him, and lo and behold, finish the story.
Yeah, his name is...
Anderson.
Yeah. Clive Anderson.
Uh-huh.
From Ireland.
Yeah.
Nice guy. So he says, where are you guys from? So I told him, I say, I'm from Lynn, and he says, really? He said, do you know David Solomini? And I said, which one? I know them both. You know, and he's a young guy, probably Joel's age, Solomini's age. And he I guess he did an internship working at on the Ocean Street Solomini's funeral home. So we bump into this guy, out of the middle of nowhere. Dumb luck kind of brought us together.
Yeah, an undertaker at that.
And then the next day, we're at the inauguration. We're leaning against the wall, listening to the speech, I believe, at that point. Yeah. And who walks by but Clive Anderson?
What are the odds of that?
Right. And you were a little concerned that if the Undertaker was hovering around you,
I told him I didn't want to see him for a while. I said, please, Lou, get lost, will you? So, with all the money to be made available for Massachusetts bridges, you would think that they would want to make contact, Eclipse, but ideology always trumps, in quotation, right, common sense with these people.
Right, so in other words, what they're saying is the guys like Isaac and all that stuff, they're not going to try to figure out a way to work with this current administration. They're going to thumb their nose, you know, give them the, what's that, what does this mean in Italian?
Italiano?
Yeah. So anyway, so you get that kind of response from those who are outraged that a guy like Trump could be the president instead of trying to figure out a way to work with him to get it. In fact, Charlie Baker, governor of Massachusetts, Republican, didn't support Trump during the election cycle, right?
That's why we had such bad seats.
He went to the inauguration, and in the newspaper they were saying, how dare he go to the inauguration? He's got to go down there and mend fences, doesn't he? I mean, his job is to try to bring home the bacon.
Of course. And by the way, folks, the caption on this was Dems skipping out on the inauguration.
Right.
That was response. And speaking to your point, the fellow that was in that photo with my granddaughter is chief of staff for Polito and deputy chief of staff
Michael Valarelli.
Good guy. Soon to be my grandson-in-law.
He made that happen for us.
He made our trip happen, yeah. Yep. And ironically, they didn't want to go. And they were having a hard time.
In the end, they got the best seats. They were like way up front. There were some good ones in Massachusetts.
But here's the irony of it all. He told me, he said, for an average hotel that they had a book down there for three nights, minimum of three nights, you know what they had to pay for it?
$10,000.
$10,000.
Right. Yeah.
You and I got to wait for a lot cheaper than that.
Well, that's because we were 45 miles out of the city.
Not that far out, but we were with the Navy.
45
we were being protected
out.
By the Navy. We're in Annapolis.
Yeah, we saw the stadium where Navy plays its football games.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And plus, you know, Paul, by the way, said, this is the capital of Maryland, isn't it? I said, very good, Paul. And I made him tell me the other four capitals to begin with A.
Yeah. And I got a couple of them wrong.
You got them in.
Yeah.
We enjoy, frankly speaking, I love this one. We enjoy, frankly speaking, very much, especially love discussions involving Trump and the biased media. Ooh, and the current ill-behaving Democratic Party. Isn't that a great, great call?
Can we talk about the biased media? How about Sean Spicer, what he did the other day? So he comes out there in an impromptu press conference, and he lambasted the media for their, as he called it, their negative bias or their negative narrative around everything that Trump does. And he didn't make any friends doing it. I think everybody's upset about it and all that kind of stuff. But I think they sent a message loud and clear. And then he had his real press conference yesterday, and he basically said, look, if you want to have a relationship with us, it's a two-way street. We expect you to be firm but fair with us. But fair is the operative word there. They have to.
Here's what bothered me. They spent that news conference, press conference, right? Talking about size crowd and Martin Luther's bust, you know, yes, no, and all that type of stuff. It was the side issues. When great things happened,
right,
where Donald Trump has done some really, really significant things. Number one, he said, oh, by the way, we're not funding abortions anymore overseas.
Internationally, yeah.
Okay. Number two, forget
TPP, gone. You know what's funny about that, the TPP? You know, all the Democrat supporters for Clinton that were union supporters are all thrilled with that because they were all trying to get it reversed.
Because it's the right thing to do.
I talked to
the Republicans. John McCain loves it, by the
Peter
way.
Peter Capano. Yeah. Everybody, you know Peter, good guy on city council, works for the local 201 union and all that stuff. Real strong worker guy. He said, I've been trying to get rid of TPP for 20 years. And he did it in one day.
Hey, would Hillary have gotten rid of?
No.
All right. You're an independent conservative guy.
Yeah.
Are you for? Were you for it?
I was not.
Neither were
I. I honestly don't feel like I have enough information to make an informed decision about whether it's good or bad. But I generally don't trust it because of who the supporters are. You know,
I generally don't trust it because it will do exactly what NAFTA did.
Right.
NAFTA drove all kinds of jobs out of the United States.
Right.
All right.
It's all about improving the bottom line for the big corporations.
By the way, those greedy big business guys that I'm not fond of.
Right, same
you
here.
You know, they, if they want to equate, you know, forget this Hitler stuff that they try to slap all over.
Right.
The guy that they should compare Trump to is Teddy Roosevelt. Teddy Roosevelt broke up monopolies. Teddy Roosevelt was a man of action. Teddy Roosevelt got things done.
San Juan Hill.
That's right. Walk softly, but
carry a big stick.
So what is Trump saying? He says, look, I don't want to tell you what to do in Iraq here and there, but I'll tell you what.
He's been waving a big stick for quite a while.
Yeah, right now, I don't have it right now, but I'm going to build it. I'm going to have the United States is going to have the greatest Army Air Force. Oh, we should have it now. Oh, no, we're going to be greater. No one is going to fool with it. Therefore, we don't get any problems.
Right.
So we actually save money in the long haul, correct?
Right. Yep.
And we're not going to involve ourselves in these petty little interventions in order to protect markets for oil men.
Right. That's all about the rent seeking. We've talked about rent seeking in the past. And in any of these lobbyists that are only interested in getting the government to pass laws that make them money, that has to stop. And that's the drain the swamp type of stuff that has to happen.
He's doing it, Paul.
Right, absolutely.
Why can't I let him do it?
There are policies that need to change that will, you know, have people who benefit from and all that kind of stuff. But it can't be because you want to benefit them. It has to be because it's good for the country.
Well, we're going to move on because the second part of that wonderful We Enjoy Franklin Speaking is about an odor emitting from a, I'm not going to mention place because I want to get caught
from
in.
From the soup place.
Yeah.
Right. But so, you know, I had not heard that the soup place was odor emanating from the soup place. I had heard, and I did know, in fact, back when I was on the city council, we had a problem with the creamery. There was some, you know, there was these disposal units that weren't being...
We don't have any answers to it, so we have to look into it.
Right, and we absolutely will. You know, I think it's the Westland Creamery is the problem, but we'll find out. And either way, we got to address it because it's not fair.
This is a very important one, and we only have about a minute or two left. I'll read the whole thing, and we're going to make some quick comments on it, and I think we have one more after that. Today's Daily Item editorial entitled Rights and Responsibilities in Lynn is a pure example of the media in Lynn attempting to distort and lie about the Parkland Avenue school site and neighborhood. No one, and I repeat, no one is anti-schools or education. Yes, it is well known that the city is in need of more schools. And the people, I feel, support that. The issue here is the site of the new school. The Parkland Avenue site is a total encroachment of Lynn Woods, a total disregard for the federally protected wetlands, along with a total disruption of the ecosystem and wildlife. The area is in a major trucking route, and to put a school at this location will jeopardize the lives of our children. It is plain and simple. The school needs to be built, but not on this site. Magnolia and Union Hospital site are better suited for this project and would be cost efficient. It would be a step in the right direction if the Daily Item reported the truth.
That isn't you and I saying that either.
I'm saying fabricate harmful editorials.
And that's a comment on our show?
Yes, I'm going to keep going. I have been a subscriber to the Daily Item for better than 40 years, and all of my 5 children delivered this paper in their youth, and that has come to an end today, as I refuse to subscribe to a totally dishonest and corrupt news media in the Daily Item.
Good for him, or her, whoever it is.
Whatever. Right. The point is that we have to examine.
But you're right. But you know, that's the straw man argument. They say they basically go and they say anybody who is opposed to building a school on Parkland Ave is against the kids.
He or she made a great point. If that's not the issue,
right? It's not. It's about where to put it
and truth.
Right.
Let's talk about the truth. Lastly, and this I think is a follow up about my rambling incoherently.
You've been known to do that, yeah.
Still wants to know where my facts are coming from. I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to keep it a secret.
Alternative facts?
Yeah. And he wants me to tell about the plans the Republicans have when they get rid of the Affordable Care Act with an alternative that may... Listen, folks, if you like that Affordable Care Act, you keep it. Because you don't like to keep it, right?
Right.
You can keep it. You can pay all you want. I like choice. They're going to give us choice. They're going to allow me to go beyond, but I can tailor it to my needs. We'll get to that a little later. But comes back with a compliment, and I got to give him credit for this. Now, with that being said, after punching me in the trunks again, he turns around and he says, I'm sick and tired of the national politics taking up the full time of the show. We're ready to move because of you. I watched you back, you two back when it was the City Voice. Enjoyed it.
Talking about the city.
Because of the banter, the back and forth, and the guests that came in and out, which we're going to get back again, and that was discussed. Can you please go back to your roots?
But we did that. Didn't we talk a lot about the city today? I hope we did, right?
We don't have the call-in show. We have a different dynamic right now.
Right.
We're about to get it back, yep. And we will rock and roll like you can't believe.
So can we make an announcement?
Not yet.
Can we announce when we'll be moving to the new location?
March is the projected date.
We're projected to move to the new location in March, and then from there, it's probably going to be a couple of months before we can actually do the live.
We'll be doing it for them. And yep. Now, guess what?
And it's coming into election season, too.
Exactly. Until we meet again, Paul.
Yep.
Folks, stay tuned. Good night.